Some films were harmed in the making of this podcast. From Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, and the Palatial FYC Studios, you're listening to For Your Consideration,
the podcast featuring roundtable discussions reevaluating the cinematic canon of past masterpieces and modern classics. I'm your host, Dustin Friesenan.
And I'm Mike Josick. And we'd like to give a shout-out to anybody catching the show on YouTube or iHeartRadio or Stitcher. And if you stream or download the podcast off of iTunes, while you're there, we'd love it if you subscribed, rated, reviewed the show, if you already haven't. Because it helps with the algorithms and potentially gets us into the eyes and ears of people who may like the podcast but not currently know about it. If you're a regular listener to the show, welcome back. If our podcast is falling on your virgin ears, if this is your first time, beware, spoilers ahead. Now, in this episode of the show, we are going to talk about a movie that we've actually been wanting to talk about for a while. Actually, this episode itself has been taking a while to kind of get going.
We're going to say percolating.
And interestingly enough, the result of waiting to cover this film has actually landed us very close to an anniversary for this film, which I think was like a couple or a few days before we're sitting down to record. And that film, of course, is The Big Lebowski.
AKA the film that apparently country music listeners would consider not bad for those who are involved in it.
The listener has to work on that one a little bit. But it's good. It's good to challenge people.
You got the... At the very end, when the guy says, well, it seems like things didn't turn out too badly for Walter and the dude, but how does he figure that? I mean, for Walter, like, all that happened was that his buddy died, but for friggin' the dude, it's exactly like a country music song. At the end of it, he doesn't have a woman. At the end of it, his vehicle is destroyed. It's set on fire. He lost his buddy who dies. He has his house completely trashed. Like, if your house was trashed, your car set on fire, and you made an enemy of a millionaire and some crazy people who were gonna kill you over friggin' $14, is that turning out all right? Come on now. Or if, as you said, that character represents God, then God doesn't know what good or bad is when it applies to humans. He doesn't know. Also, dummeries just seem to make a lot more sense in my head sometimes. It's an inside joke that only I know.
And as I like to do on the show, every time we watch one of these movies, I like to just specify what format we watched it in. And this one we caught on my DVD, which was the Big Lebowski widescreen collector's edition that came out in February of 2013, and that was a Universal Studios release. I always find Coen Brothers DVDs, films are great, features are somewhat lackluster. There's just, they don't do commentaries, and the making ofs are often very short EPK kind of stuff. So other than the film, I can't really, you know, recommend this version, but
it doesn't seem as though there's any version in particular you'd have to recommend.
I'd have to go looking. I haven't, since acquiring this one, I haven't really upgraded, so. But, you know, watching this movie, I forgot how much I like this movie, which might be a bit of a spoiler for the summation at the end.
You warned them. Spoilers ahead. That is all right.
I did. So let's get to the credits, and we'll get... Oh, actually, before we get to the credits, I just wanted to qualify. Originally, we were supposed to have a guest host for this episode. I think on the last episode, the Superman episode, I did say there's a chance that might not pan out. And as you may be able to tell, that hasn't panned out. Our guest had another commitment, and we just wanted to kind of get the episode done and move on. So perchance we will have this guest come back at some point, but...
In the meantime, you're stuck with us?
You're stuck with us, but then you're stuck with us with pretty much every other episode anyway, so if you're here, you're here. So
I'm also going to say that you have no choice. You have to keep listening to us. All have to listen to us. That would be very awesome. It would help us out greatly if we had 7 billion views per episode.
We're working on it. We're working on it. So, The Big Lebowski was directed by Joel Coen. It was produced by Ethan Coen. It was written by Joel and Ethan Coen. It starred Jeff Bridges, John Goodman, Julianne Moore, Steve Buscemi, David Huddleston, John Turturro, and countless other people who we will probably touch on over the course of our discussion.
None of whom you've ever heard of, obviously, based off of the first part of that list.
None of them that maybe you've heard of. David Thewlis? Tara Reid?
Actually, David Thewlis is... David Thewlis is the first name I did not recognize.
Peter Stormare? Like, come on, man.
That's what I'm saying. It's a joke.
It was narrated...
God!
That's hilarious you said that, because I was just about to say it was narrated by Sam Elliott. Also known as The Stranger or God, depending on your interpretation. Music was by Carter Burwell. Cinematography by the amazing Roger Deakins. It was edited by Roderick Janes and Trisha Cook. It was distributed by... Gramercy Pictures and Polygram Film Entertainment in the US and UK respectively, and was released in the US on March 6th, 1998. 3 days ago. This is anniversary shit, man.
We will pretend as though it was planned.
The film was generally well received and has gone on to become quite the cult classic, pretty beloved in the canon of the Coen brothers and the actors within, Bridges, Goodman, and Buscemi.
And it's made it up to 235th on the Critics' Poll for BFI's Sight and Sound Top Films of All Time, and 132nd on the Director's Poll, so none too shabby, really.
Is 132nd the highest on the Director's Poll we've ever had?
No, we did, like, number two. Well, you did number one, Vertigo.
That was number one on the Critics. Was it two on Directors?
Yeah.
Just trying to forget that movie. That's not true. That's not true. Anyways.
Now they're going to write in again.
The writing campaign will start again.
About how we know nothing.
But that's the point. That's the point of this. The point is to, like, get out there and say what we think and start a conversation. Because, like, the whole thesis of the show is...
Question the unquestioned.
Question the unquestioned. So, this was one of several viewings for me. And at the time of actually watching it, it was Dustin's first time experiencing The Big Lebowski. What did you think of the film? And I would like you, of course, to be... very good and thorough in your analysis.
He's really trying to shoehorn that reference in there. I saw him pull out the shoehorn earlier, and he managed to get it in.
I was buffing it up, getting it nice and shiny so that the heel of that joke would just slide right in.
I still feel that you really flubbed it. That's okay, because you're gonna edit out this comment on it and just see yourself as being super clever.
Well, while you start with your thoughts, I'm going to go check for some aloe vera to apply to that sick burn.
Don't forget your antibiotics, I guess, as it was sick. Ignoring all this dumb back and forth repartee.
Which is totally staying in.
I very much enjoyed The Big Lebowski. It's one of those films where the comedy is... all over the place, but it feels very natural from these characters. It feels like you're just on the outside looking in, as the stranger would have been, just sort of hearing about this story. And it's utterly ridiculous through and through, but at the same time, sort of believable, as long as you ignore the fact that the dude lives in a pretty nice place for somebody who's apparently unemployed.
I love the fact that this movie has... it has this very complicated plot that's going on somewhere else.
There's a lot of ins and outs. Like, there's stuff happening that... and I got this information that maybe you didn't have. So maybe things are just happening and, you know?
And the dude gets occasionally dragged into this stupid story that's going on somewhere else involving all of these characters and all of this stuff. And because we're following the story from the dude's point of view, we've got the dude, Walter, and Donnie. You get to sort of see the ridiculousness of what, air quote, normal people are up to. And it's brilliant. Like, at times, the movie just sort of, you know, the dude gets involved in the plot. Something happens. There's a money drop-off, or he goes to talk to, like, the billionaire Lebowski. But then he just sort of goes back to his world, and he's bowling, and there's Jesus. The whole Jesus thing, it never really plays out to anything
He's got other thing. He's got other shit going on in his life.
There's Jesus, the league. He's there. Like, there's the league championship that they're looking towards, and like that's sort of that's the dude's story. And then there's the Lebowski story. I love how there are times where you kind of wonder, am I even watching a movie with a real story, or am I just watching a slice of life? And then you get pulled in and dragged along for a while, and then you kind of come back, and then there's like a weird dream sequence, and then
it's basically a slice of life because you. I love how they have the bowling league and Smokey calling up the dude later on as he's just dancing around on his new carpet that he sort of scammed out of the theoretically rich Lebowski. And the rich Lebowski giving him shit for being unemployed when technically he's just living off of an allowance anyway. Like, welcome to the show, Mr. Pot.
It's a caprice of the rich.
Apparently. But then you have, like, his landlord comes by, talks about the dance
his thing landlord that he is has so going good. On.
And later on, when Sobchak comes in, when Walter comes in, talking about this, that, the other, when he found out who he thought had the money, they're at the dance, just watching him flop about like a weird middle-aged guy. But it's, yeah, he's got other stuff going on. He's got other lives that he's part of, and it all just sort of happens around him, and he never gets too riled up by it. The dude abides, right?
The stuff that's in the dude's life, like the weird little things that probably seem like asides, like the dance recital, like the bowling stuff, that's the stuff that's important to the dude. That's the stuff that he's actually, that's where his focus is, and he keeps getting distracted by this other stuff in this other world. That,
well, he's kind of hoping for that 20 grand.
He was. And you mentioned the phone calls on the answering machine, and I love how that call from the league, from the bowling league, saying that there was a complaint about Walter pulling the gun at the bowling alley, it takes just as much importance as the phone call that's technically driving the plot from Philip Seymour Hoffman, another actor who wasn't on the credits list.
And I love just Philip Seymour Hoffman's nervous laughter at everything that goes wrong, especially when Bunny offers to suck the dude's dick for $1,000. She's wonderful. We love her free-spirited enthusiasm.
Every character in this movie has such a specific personality. No one character is the same. You might be able to kind of lump nihilists in together because
we don't care about nothing.
But yeah, every character has a very specific tone and attitude and personality, and they're allowed to just express that to the fullest capacity within the story. And like watching Julianne Moore, even like David Thewlis, who has, what, like 30 seconds in the movie? Maybe 2 minutes in the movie, just sitting there in the chair laughing like an idiot? Has a very distinct, unique personality. It's something that I really love about this movie. And also, they're all a little hyperbolic, but none of them are, like, mugging. It's all extremely natural. It's all completely real. They all believe this world of their characters. They bring them to life with such...
I even love how the conversations, like, they'll stop midway through because they had a shift of thought. When Walter's freaking out about how he didn't go to Nam for this and that. And by the way, the Chinaman is not the preferred nomenclature. Like, he just suddenly completely shifts gears and goes over here, and he's bouncing all over, and he always brings it back to Nam. Everything that happens.
Walter's entire, like, world experience revolves around his experience in Vietnam.
And Donnie just, he's very focused on his bowling and always comes in not knowing what the heck's going on in the conversation, and Walter is having none of that ever.
Donnie is so milquetoast, and so, while his character doesn't actually do anything, I couldn't imagine Donnie not being there. If it was just Walter and the dude, it would be a different dynamic.
I'm guessing that in the bowling league, you have the extra for some reason. Because the other teams had a third person as well, but it's always the two people who they were bowling against. Whenever they talked about it for the next league match is this person and this person, but even that team had a third guy sitting in the background, so Donnie's sort of that third wheel. I'm guessing he's the extra in case one of them gets sick.
Or it's
Shomer Shabbos.
I don't know how bowling leagues work. I work with someone who does.
This is just what I'm inferring here.
We do have access to the internet. We could look this up.
That is not natural. That is unnatural. and to go in with this period piece because it was specifically stated as being somewhere in the 90s.
I remember having that discussion with you right off the huff where I think you were wondering about it being dated and...
It didn't matter because as soon as it's a period piece, it's not dated anymore.
Exactly.
It's impossible.
It lives in that time period in which it was filmed. Even though the film looks pretty timeless to me, like, this movie could take place for all intents and purposes in 2019, as far as I'm concerned.
Except for you probably wouldn't be given that big old shoulder holster phone. After the drop-off goes sour and he's just carrying it around, letting it ring, why are you carrying it if you're not going to answer it? But I love the fact that he does. It's great.
even if this was a contemporary story and he got that weird phone, I think I'd still go for it because this world that the Coens have created is so bizarre. It's so absurdly rooted in reality. But
the phone is literally the only thing that doesn't fit with modern day. Everything else is entirely modern day.
I sometimes wonder if Julian from the Trailer Park Boys was partly inspired by the Lebowski, the dude. I don't watch Trailer Park Boys, so I don't know any of the behind-the-scenes stuff there. But just the way he goes around with his rum and coke and just always has his rum and coke reminds me of how the dude always has his White Russian.
Though at one point he orders a Caucasian, so I don't know what's up with that.
Is that just another name for a White Russian?
I have no idea.
Again, like bowling, we don't know great deals about alcohol and mixes. We are not mixologists.
Most of my mixology has come from playing video games.
We are filmologists, not mixologists.
You're a professional scubaologist. I'm a professional electrolalologist.
Dustin refers... I don't know if we've ever mentioned my other podcast, which is a Scooby-Doo-related podcast.
Once or twice.
Have we? On this show?
Yeah.
Okay.
But he has been paid for his Scooby-Doo knowledge now, so I like to refer to him as a professional scubologist. That is all it requires to be a professional, is to get paid for something.
That's true.
Which is why I want to get paid like a dollar for a bunch of menial or random tasks, so that I can call myself a professional whatever.
Dude, we do have Patreon supporters.
Yeah, which is why I consider myself a professional podcaster. Back to the timelessness of the film. There's just so many like small things that I definitely love happening. How far, like, when he, not to be exactly like Lebowski and get stuck in a sentence and then suddenly shift gears, he's driving around smoking pot, tries to flick it out the window because he gets distracted, lands in his lap, and he's swerving around, hits the dumpster. How far that car jumps when he hits that dumpster and just the dumbfounded look on his face. The fact that he has those shades pulls him out a couple of times, even out of the toilet at the beginning. Right before the dude asks him and makes my favorite joke in the film. What is this, holding the bowling ball? Well, obviously you're not a golfer. He just takes everything in such stride. The dude abides.
Both car accidents are actually... Is it two? I think it's two. They're spectacular. The collision with the post on the bridge and the collision with the dumpster, which you just referred to.
Walter is so lucky he didn't shoot himself and that Uzi was just going
off. I know. But that's something I really appreciate in films and television shows because car accidents are usually played up.
They get sometimes, the spring underneath and every car always flips and it explodes in the flames for no reason.
Yeah, or they'll switch to the view from inside because they want you to feel the impact from that perspective. And for anybody who's ever been in a car accident or seen a car accident, it just looks like two hunks of metal or one hunk of metal hitting like some other something. And it's weirdly silent until it's not. And it's weirdly abrupt.
And it's over in 2 seconds. I saw one just the other week on the way to work. And it was just like, oh, there's a blip on the radar.
Yeah. And so when I see that in a movie or a TV show where there's no music, there's no fanfare, it's just the sound effect of a car, you know, moving and then a crunch and then it's over. I like that a lot.
His car still ran after both accidents. It wasn't until it was set on fire that it's like, they did it. They finally killed my car. Which somehow is turning out not too bad for him, according to the storyteller.
Well, you know, maybe he's got a new car. Maybe he's taking public transit. We don't know.
He's unemployed. How is he avoiding any of that?
He doesn't have to pay insurance for his car. In fact,
he even have insurance?
I was just
going to
say he probably didn't already. Yes.
He certainly didn't do anything about all the other damage that's happened to it. It was impounded. I don't know where he got the money to get that out, or to get all the weed and the alcohol he's drinking. That's the only unrealistic thing, the amount of money this guy happens to have kicking around for all this random side stuff.
He could be on unemployment. He could be getting regular checks.
I've been on unemployment. You can't get nothing off of that.
Yeah. So let's talk about the cast briefly. We've brought it up a couple of times since the beginning of the conversation. And there's so much talent assembled here. And everybody is just sort of in their place doing their things. I just remembered while you were talking about the car accidents that Ben Gazzara is in the movie playing the porn guy, Jackie Treehorn.
Jackie Treehorn.
And
which reminds me of my buddy's favorite joke, where he's writing down something after a phone call. The dude runs up. What's going on here? Does the whole pencil scribble thing to see if he can get the... to see if he can figure out what was written. And it's just a drawing of a dude with a big dick. What was going on in that phone call? That's what I want to know.
I think it was just an idle doodle. And I think that's probably what Jackie Treehorn thinks about when he's just idly doing things.
And not lamenting the lack of story in porn these days. Everything's going electronic. It's the future.
What does Julianne Moore say? The plot is atrocious.
Oh, yeah, while watching the porn.
The plot is non-existent.
The plot is ridiculous.
So you've got Ben Gazzara. You've got Philip Seymour Hoffman. You've got Jeff Bridges. You've got John Goodman. You've got Steve Buscemi. You've got John Turturro. Sam Elliott. David Thewlis. Julianne Moore. Tara Reid. Peter Stormare. Flea. I can't remember the name of the guy that plays the Big Lebowski.
Jeff Bridges?
No, Rich Lebowski.
Oh, Rich Lebowski.
Jeff Bridges is the dude, my friend.
You're Mr. Lebowski. I'm the dude. Or his dudeness, or duder.
I keep wanting to talk about the cast, and I keep getting distracted into other scenes. I want to talk about the sheriff who throws the freaking...
Coffee mug
at his head. I wasn't listening. Oh, man. And
fascist? Or any time that John Goodman just decides he's going to be a five-year-old.
You want a toe? I can get you a toe.
Not necessarily that, but just you can see in his acting, like it was superbly done when he's getting berated for having pulled out the gun. It's like, I'm calm. Calmer than you. And he has to repeat himself. I'm calmer than you. Or when he was about to get kicked out for making the disturbance at the coffee shop, I'm going to sit here and drink my coffee.
I'm staying.
Enjoying my coffee. Looking around, just looking all smug. He's such a five-year-old in those scenes, but he plays it up and it is great. And it is exactly what you'd expect of Soap Jack.
I love the moment at the end when he throws Donnie to the wind and the ashes just fly back into the dude's face and the dude just loses it on Walter. Because by that point...
What was that shit about numb, man?
Because
what does it have to do with anything?
By that point, I felt just like the dude. I was so... I mean, as entertained as I am by Walter, I was so tired of Walter and the numb stories. And like Donnie, who had been abused for the entire movie, was dead. And really, what had come of anything? And Walter was such a force of
chaos, pure, unadulterated chaos. He was wrong about everything the whole time, freaking out at poor Donnie, freaking out about Shomer Shabbos, freaked out to Jeff Bridges just recently about how you don't just get rid of becoming Jewish just because you divorced the chick. That's not how it works. You don't turn in your library card. You don't get a new license. And there's so many scenes where they're getting all riled up and then they calm right the heck back down. The fact that the dude, the only times he ever gets riled up in the entire film is because of Walter. The dude abides, but he only barely abides Walter.
It is a weird friendship. It is a really weird trifecta of characters that you wouldn't expect to be together.
Donnie puts up with a lot of shit from Walter.
Because Walter is so keyed up and the dude is so chill. And Donnie is accommodating. So you could actually see how Donnie would be friends with either the dude or Walter. Because he will take the abuse. Or he's just as chill as the dude. He's not going to challenge the dude or make the dude's life any more difficult. But you're kind of surprised why Donnie stays at all.
He because definitely he does get so much himself, abuse. Though. Does not stick up for himself whatsoever. One thing, though, I noticed about Donnie, though, is the look on his face at the end, right before he died, after he bowled, but there was one pin left. Like, it almost seemed like he knew something was up. You had Walter talking about the difference between fighting in jungles, well, basically the Vietnam War and Desert Storm in the background, sort of really quiet, and everything is, the sound, the way the sound is working in that scene, everything's a bit slower, the look on Steve Buscemi's face. It's almost like something was wrong with him at that point, prior to the heart attack in the parking lot.
Oh, interesting. I didn't catch that. I have never caught that.
Well, I'll show it to you after we record here, and we'll see if you think I'm just crazy.
We could pause it and do it right now, and then we can talk about it.
All right, then.
So, in a podcast first, we've just stopped the show, checked out the scene, and we're back to comment on it. I think you might be onto something. It's one of the few moments in the movie particularly focused on Donnie.
There's basically two of them, and both of them are him bowling. The first one, he gets a strike, and he's like, "Woo! I'm on fire tonight!" And he comes in, doesn't catch what Walter was saying, and Walter freaks out at him several times because he wasn't part of the conversation. And now here, he's not part of the conversation. He misses the one pin, but everything is so downcast. It is, if anything is foreshadowing, it is that little scene right there.
And they play a little bit with the timing, with the, goes into slow-mo, and it kind of comes out of the slow-mo, and you can tell he's got a look on his face that there's definitely something wrong. I think you might be onto something, Dustin.
He's not even asking what's going on in the conversation. He's just there rubbing his palm. And you could say that he's just really dejected that he didn't get that strike, but he didn't get the strike, which means it was his first go. He's not even up grabbing the next ball. He's just sitting there. He's done for a little bit. Of course, he could be waiting for his individual ball, but still.
Meanwhile, the dude is doing his nails. And Walter is talking about
the differences between Desert Storm and Vietnam. Because war is Walter's life. And he's the only person who we really know his job. Sobchak Security.
Yeah, I guess we don't know anything about Donnie.
We know that he was a surfer, because that was part of the eulogy. It's the first time we really learn anything about Donnie, honestly.
I mean, Donnie's not really integral to the plot. He's just part of the dude's sort of actual life.
The dude's not integral to the plot. At the end of the day, the only thing that happened is a lot of rampant property destruction, the dude getting beaten up. Really, it was just like a really hectic, crappy week for the dude, which apparently is all fine and dandy. Turns out well enough for him. It's equivalent to Walter's day, apparently.
I often find it difficult doing a show on a movie that I enjoy this much when there's...
You want to talk about everything all at once, and it's hard to be as analytical, because you're sitting there getting excited about scenes. And
it is a lot harder to be analytical in the sense where you're actually like picking apart this scene or that scene. I'm really glad you brought up the Donnie thing, because I was really, you know, fishing for some actual analysis of the filmmaking in this movie. Because for me, it's one of those movies where the filmmaking is invisible and it just kind of washes over you. Like the cinematography by Roger Deakins, it's beautiful, but it's not in your face. You're not looking at lights coming in through the slats of the blinds thing, and the music by Carter Burwell, you don't really notice it. More than anything, you probably walk away from this movie thinking about the Bob Dylan song, the Man in Me song.
Really, I'm more on the Gypsy Kings version of Hotel California.
Ah, yes.
And that's right, I actually knew the artist of that one.
So yeah, I find it, I mean, there are movies, I haven't seen this movie as often as I've seen something like, you know, Jaws or Star Wars, so I'm still in that kind of honeymoon phase with it, where
probably the most artistic stuff you're going to get out of it are the two scenes where the dude has been knocked out. And then, of course, then you're going into flying through LA skies and then getting run over by a bowling ball, or you're having him thinking that he's in a porn. What was that? Gutter balls. And then the whole weird little dance scene and him floating around out of there. And like the start of the whole gutter balls thing, I enjoyed, but I felt that really went on too long when he's going down the lane and he spins around to look up all the dresses and he spins around again. That one started dragging out.
Interesting.
When it came to the visions. And the first one I felt kind of about. Like, it was amusing at first, but even that one, both of them felt like they were twice as long as they should have been, even though the first one was like 15, 20 seconds at best.
I don't feel length when I'm watching this movie. I don't feel running time with this movie. When we watched it, I knew it was a 2-hour movie, but it just, at no point am I feeling the passage of time. There's just this logical progression. You're watching these characters maneuvering through this story, and it's all entertaining. I'm a little surprised that you felt that those dream sequences were a little too long. I didn't get a sense of that myself.
Well, someone's got to say that it's not a perfect film. One quality of the dude that I really enjoy is that as he's going through the film, he'll hear a piece of information, or he'll hear a saying, hear a word, and he brings it up later on as though he's trying to sort of incorporate all this stuff into himself. He uses, in the parlance of our time, when talking about Bunny being a slut because he heard it from Maud, he talks about...
Well, he's trying to fit in with these people, and he's, like, trying to adopt their language.
Well, it's not the only time that he does it. I can't for the life of me think of one of the other times, but I know he does it at least, like, 4 times, where he brings up something that happened prior, and it keeps coming back, and he's the only one doing that specific kind of callback.
The dude is just ever-changing and evolving.
He's taking in a whole lot more than you'd think he would be. It's his very strict drug regimen, which is keeping his mind limber.
I thought that was a worthwhile, like, character-wise. I mean, contextually, it had a point to be in there, but I liked the fact... Because he comes off as just, like, this total stoner.
But to have him qualify that... He cracks the case. He gets the information. He puts it all together. But at the same time, he's surprised as heck when Maud is talking about trying to increase her chances of conception, and he's like, whoa, 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 there's something about the dude you gotta know. And I'm thinking, dude, that means that you weren't wearing a condom and you came inside her and you didn't have this conversation. Come on now, buddy. Come on. Don't be this shocked. You should maybe look out for yourself a little bit more.
I said that it's kind of difficult for me to talk about this movie in any specific sort of way, other than just talking about scenes that I love or characters that I love and getting into an actual analysis of the movie. I think that's just as valid an analysis of the movie as going in there and getting your fingers in there and picking it apart, because if the whole thing just sits in you, if you just, you view it and you consume it and you just feel good about it and you really liked what you saw and all of the components of that movie, the acting, the writing, the direction, the lighting, the camera work, the music.
It all feels natural. It doesn't
none of it
stick
sticks
in your
out
craw.
Yeah, like, other than just some of the really snappy lines and whatever, like, you really have to watch the movie over and over and over and over again to catch the really, really subtle stuff. I think for me, like, that's just as much a commentary on the movie. Even though I'm kind of criticizing myself for not being able to be as thorough as I would like.
There's certainly a lot to the claim that that mispronunciation reminds me of something that the dude does, where he's talking about, oh, sometimes you eat the bar and sometimes the bar eats you, right? It's him pulling back from everything, even just a conversation with a stranger. But yeah, there's a lot of things where if they're doing it right, you shouldn't notice it.
No, exactly.
You'll notice bad lighting. You'll notice bad cinematography. You'll notice bad this, that, the other. And if something is good and spectacular, it doesn't mean necessarily that you will notice it. Just that it wasn't something that was distracting you. We weren't distracted by all the technical aspects, so we could just fully enjoy the story, the dialogue, the banter, the repartee.
And on repeated viewings, you know, I haven't seen it 100,000 times like Raiders of the Lost Ark, but...
It'll give you something to look for.
Every time I've seen this film, I've enjoyed it immensely. I've found myself laughing for myself with my friends. We're always talking about the movie as we're watching it, and we talk about it, you know, briefly afterwards. It's a movie that sticks with you, and I can't think of any higher compliment for a movie.
So obviously you're saying that it's museum piece. That's what I'm hearing here.
Well,
that is a lie.
That's just your opinion, man. Yes, scored one.
There you go. You got it.
This was a...
Yeah, man, it really tied the room together.
So this was a valued...
What tied the room together, dude?
My rug.
Were you listening to the dude's story, Donnie?
Walter.
Were you listening to the dude's story?
I was bowling.
So you have no frame of reference here, Donnie. You're like a child who wanders into the middle of a movie and wants to know...
Walter, what's the point, man?
There's no reason. Here's my point, dude. There's no fucking reason why these...
Yeah, Walter, what's your point?
Huh?
Walter, what is the point? Look, we all know who is at fault here. What the fuck are you talking about?
Huh? No, what the fuck are you... I'm not... We're talking about unchecked aggression here,
What the
dude.
Fuck is he talking
my
about?
My rug.
Forget Look, it, Donnie. You're Walter, out of your element.
Walter, the Chinaman who peed on my rug, I can't go give him a bill. So what the fuck are you talking about?
What the fuck are you talking about? The Chinaman is not the issue here, dude. I'm talking about drawing a line in the sand, dude. Across this line, you do not. Also, dude, Chinaman is not the preferred nomenclature. Asian American, please.
So I know we just kind of basically did our summation over the last couple of minutes, but moving into the official judgment phase, judgment segment of the podcast, Dustin, are you going to shock us and surprise us? what did you think of The Big Lebowski? Would you consider it a masterpiece or a museum piece?
I would say that The Big Lebowski is easily a masterpiece. As a comedy, this hits everything it should, other than some vulgarity in language. It's not a gross-out comedy, so it's fairly appropriate for a lot of people. Though the stranger would say, do you really have to cuss as much? To which the dude would respond, what the fuck are you talking about?
Even though there is like a porno aspect to the film, like even that is not offensive.
All the breasts were classy. The constant talk of vaginas, classy. The bad porn,
does the
classy.
Sight of a woman's form offend you, Mr. Lebowski?
It can offend a lot of people, even just talking about it. But no, this film is an excellent film. I have seen it twice this month already. 2.75 times, probably. There's some awkward rewatching parts because you try to watch with someone who has to leave and this, that, the other. Anywho, no, it is a fantastic film that I would definitely revisit in the future. And it is something that it's not lacking in quality anywhere. Any of the gripes I might have about it are sort of the cliches, like the unemployed person with the fairly big home with all the seeming financial capabilities that you wouldn't see of somebody with any sort of actual money. The fact that there is not really much of a character arc for most anybody. They're all fairly static characters. But it's sort of a slice of life where there isn't a character arc because there's not a big man versus man sort of what is the struggle here. There's no struggle. This is just stuff that's going on in the life of the dude and Walter and the Big Lebowski and Maude and everybody.
That's, I think, for me, I'm also going to classify this movie as a masterpiece because of all the things that I mentioned before, just kind of the flawlessness of its execution. But also, you know, like you said, there isn't a lot of story there. It's kind of a slice of life. The characters don't have these arcs where they necessarily learn something. You know, they haven't evolved necessarily. Donnie has changed because he's dead.
Was he alive to begin with, though?
And that is part of the magic of this movie. It's effortless. Like, this movie doesn't seem to be trying at any point. And it just continues to succeed and entertain. I'm sure as I continue to watch it, I'll start, you know, noticing little things. And I may even start digging through behind-the-scenes stuff. I recently just read Jeff Bridges was talking about his famous roles, and he was talking about doing The Big Lebowski, and he was convinced that the whole dream sequence, the position I hold song with the floating around and the flying and the whatever, he was convinced that wasn't going to work, but he did what they told him to, and it clearly works in the movie. And I'm going to watch for things like the Donnie scene that you were talking about. I think there is clearly stuff in there, but I think I'm just enjoying it so much on the surface every time I watch it. I'm not compelled to dig. It's like a warm bath. You know? You're not wondering why the water is warm or how the water got warm or...
You're just hoping that no one throws a marmot in it.
You're just relaxing and enjoying it. And when you're done, you're like, I'm going to take a bath again sometime. I'm definitely going to watch The Big Lebowski again sometime. I think everybody should. I think some people take it to kind of like a weird cult-like level where it's maybe a little too far.
Where maybe the dude becomes some sort of revered figure. But no, this is, it's the kind of thing that any movie should aspire towards, to be something you can't complain about, something that you will remember, and something that you will revisit.
It's in my top three Coen Brothers movies. It's one of my favorite crime movies. Because it is a crime movie.
Embezzlement's a crime.
And I don't think there's any single person... Like, you know how you recommend movies, but you don't recommend certain movies to certain people because you just know it's not their bag? I would say everybody should try The Big Lebowski. Because I think...
It's fairly universal.
It
As
is.
A comedy, it's it universal, is. And that's hard to do.
It's a masterpiece.
So there you go. Two votes for masterpiece for The Big Lebowski. I'm actually not surprised by this judgment. I kind of thought this was going to happen going in. But Dustin does sometimes send some curveballs my way.
You never know. Speaking of curveballs, next time on the show, Mike's already dreading this. See, a certain director caused a bit of a stir when The House That Jack Built came out, and I've been unable to find a nice unedited version of it. Apparently, part of that is due to the fact that distributors didn't want to have a director's cut and a regular cut out at the same time. That's insane to me, but alright, whatever. So, I want a bit of Lars von Trier in my life, so let's get some Antichrist going on.
So that's going to be our next episode, and until we get there, we'd like to know what you think of our thoughts on The Big Lebowski, or just The Big Lebowski as a film itself. Feel free to contact us on Facebook or on Twitter. We are at FYC Show on Twitter. On Facebook, just search For Your Consideration. We're on Instagram. We are on WordPress, fycshow.wordpress.com. And if you are enjoying the show, if you like the content that we are producing and you want to support us, you know, like and share on social media, spread the word. And if you want to support us in a slightly more robust way, we do have a Patreon page, and you can go on and contribute financially to the cause. Helps us keep the lights on, kind of keep doing what we're doing. And I think we've got some fun reward levels, so feel free to check that out, patreon.com/FYC show. So thanks so much for joining us. We will see you guys next time when we talk about Lars von Trier's Antichrist. Take care, stay safe, keep fit,
have fun. Don't take life too seriously. Abide.
I've been your host, Mike Josick.
And I've been your host, Dustin Friesenen.
And until then, remember
that out there, the dude is taking it easy for all us sinners. And it makes me feel better to know that.
Food for thought.
Well, actually, it doesn't make me feel better to know that. I don't know how that helps anybody. But God apparently enjoys that, so. I think of him as the stranger. You can call him God. I don't know. That's your discussion. Tell us, is he God or is he just some random dude?
God or stranger? Discuss. Peace.
Peace. Set your love ablaze. Set your love ablaze. Set your love ablaze. Welcome to the Hotel California. Set your love ablaze. Set your love ablaze. Speaking of penises, after...
Oh, wait, what?
After the dude has sex with Maud...
I'm cutting that out.
What?